In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Hello, and welcome indeed to St. Stephen Walbrook and to our Choral Eucharist. And a welcome to those of you joining online. And a special welcome to Roger, who has negotiated storm, tempest, the challenges of the railways to be with us from Nottingham. Very grateful, Roger. Look forward to your speaking to us. We turn to the order of service and pray together. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Please have a seat. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Lord, we beseech thee to keep thy household, the church, in continual godliness, that through thy protection it may be free from all adversities and devoutly given to serve thee in good works, to the glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The epistle is taken from the fifth chapter of the book of Revelation, beginning at the first verse. Then I saw in the right hand of the one seated on the throne a scroll written on the inside and on the back, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a mighty angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the scroll and break its seals?" And no one in heaven or on earth or under the earth was able to open the scroll or to look into it. And I began to weep bitterly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or to look into it. Then one of the elders said to me, "Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals." Then I saw between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders a lamb standing as if it had been slaughtered, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. He went and took the scroll from the right hand of the one who was seated on the throne. When he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. They sing a new song. "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals. For you were slaughtered, and by your blood you ransomed for God saints from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests serving our God, and they will reign on earth. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel is written in the 19th chapter of the Gospel according to St. Luke, beginning at the 41st verse. Glory be to thee, O Lord. As he came near and saw the city, he wept over it, saying, "If you, even you, had only recognized on this day the things that make for peace, now they are hidden from your eyes. Indeed, the days will come upon you when your enemies will set up ramparts around you and surround you and hem you in on every side. They will crush you to the ground, you and your children within you, and they will not leave within you one stone upon another, because you did not recognize the time of your visitation from God." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Please be seated. I wonder how many of us remember in our youth if we were a member of one of the youth organisations, say the Boy Scouts or the Girl Guides or Boys Brigade or Girls Brigade, and so on. And in those times together, I'm sure we learnt all sorts of new things that helped us along life's pathway. I remember we were often taught how to tie knots. You know, I've even had to know the difference between a reef knot and a granny knot, and still use it when tying up parcels. We also had to learn about the bowline, which we were assured would be very useful if you have to get a sheep out of a ditch. Well, I've never had to try it out, that one. But I remember once being at a church parade full of young people, and the man who came to speak was an Anglican clergyman, and to get their attention, he started to get them to tie a few knots. And then he said, "But this morning, I'm going to tell you about four different types of knot, which could help you for many years." And he said, "If you excuse the pun, you'll see what I mean." And he got a handkerchief out of his pocket and tied a knot in one corner. And he said, "This is my forget knot. Forget knot." And he quoted that famous psalm, "Bless the Lord, O my soul," says the psalmist, "and forget not all his benefits." And on reflection, I thought how wonderful that is, that we start each day blessing the Lord for his goodness. There's that lovely prayer, isn't it? The general thanksgiving, to thank for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life. I once met a lovely Christian man. He must have been well into his 90s, but he said he tries to start each day, no matter what's going on outside, just counting his blessings. And he started to sing it to me. Count your blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. But the main thing was, he said, when the need arises and you're feeling down, remember the forget not. And then he got all his audience to tie another knot in their handkerchief. And he said, call this one your fear not. Fear not. You know, we read in the scriptures so much about the assurance that fear, yes, will come, but God will be with us in that situation. And that can make a huge difference. I was reading the autobiography of a clergyman, and he was talking about his younger days when he had just left college and been to the pastorate of his first church. And the one thing he was dreading was to take a funeral. He hadn't done one before, and it turned out to be a child's funeral. And he got so worried and het up about it that he went to his superintendent minister and said, could you do the service instead of me? But this is what the answer was given. And it was very wise. It said this, no, you do it, young man, and you will find that God is there to meet you. He is in those circumstances now, even before you get there, and he will not let you down. My God, in his loving kindness, will meet you at every corner. And I don't know about you, but maybe you've got a tough week ahead, a hospital appointment, maybe an operation, or a crisis situation. Will God be there with us to help us? Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, because thou art with me. So let's not forget that fear not. And then he took a handkerchief again and on another corner and said, this is your fret not. Fret not. The psalmist often talks us not to fret. And sometimes we do, unnecessarily. Many years ago, I attended a service, and when they presented the offerings of money at the altar, at the end of the service, the preacher said, wouldn't it be great if, as well as putting money in a plate, there was some technique where we could put our problems in the same plate as we're presenting them to God to help us to solve them. And everyone thought that was a good idea. But he said, I wonder how many of us would tiptoe up to the altar and take our problem home with us, not expecting anything to happen, but fretting about it. So that fret not is something that can be very, very frustrating and makes us feel down. But if we've committed to God, he will help us through it. So fret not. And the last corner of the handkerchief is the faint not. The faint not. Not giving up, not losing heart. You know, there's a wonderful piece of scripture, isn't it, which really helped us with that. When he says this, wait and trust upon the Lord, and he shall renew your strength. You shall run and not be weary, and we shall walk and not faint. And at a service like this, when we gather around at the Eucharist, that's a way to help us to renew our spiritual energy, not to faint, not to give up in this adventure. In our gospel reading today, we read those words when Jesus looked over Jerusalem. Jesus wept because he knew what was going to happen. And people were really absolutely astonished at what he was saying. But also in the Gospels, he tells us how to cope with this crisis-type situation. So no matter what the news is outside today, and it could be very grim, let's remember that God is still working his purposes out as year succeeds to year. And let's take as our armor that handkerchief. Forget not. Fear not. Fret not, faint not, because God is with us and will never let us down. Amen.
Many thanks indeed, Roger, on behalf of all of us, for those wise words and those wonderfully memorable graphic illustrations. Thank you. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. We stand to sing our offertory hymn number 296, Lord enthroned in heavenly splendour, during which we'll take a collection for the work of the church. Let us pray. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, and the assurance that we have eternal life through him. May we remember that through him we are called to serve you in every aspect of our lives. O Heavenly Father, who has filled the world with beauty, open our eyes to behold your creation and the fact that your hand is in all your works, that you resonate throughout the world. We rejoice in that creation, and may we learn to serve you with gladness. We hold before you all in your world who are suffering in any form at this time. And we pray for peace throughout the world. We pray for peace in Ukraine and all other areas of the world blighted by conflict. And we pray for peace in Jerusalem, the city over which Jesus wept. We pray that that city will know permanent reconciliation and peace. We pray for the peoples of Israel and the lands of the Palestinians, that they will work for lasting peace, and that those who suffer deprivation will be filled and lifted high. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And on this day, when the church remembers St. Hugh of Lincoln, we thank you for his example, his devotion to you, and especially his commitment to combating anti-Semitism, particularly prevalent in the 13th century. We pray that anti-Semitism will be condemned, rejected and removed from your world. We lament the involvement in the church over the years in anti-Semitism. And we pray that all discrimination and persecution will be removed from your world. And we pray that our church will become more inclusive, more active in repelling discrimination. We pray for all members of your church, especially those who are persecuted. We pray for the work of the church in London, the communities of the city churches, and the community of this church. Give us energy and courage to live your gospel and shine your light. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for all those known to us in a particular need at this time, all those suffering from sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. We pray for those struggling under economic pressures at this time. Pray for the homeless, the lonely, the bereaved, those who suffer from addiction, those in troubled relationships. May you draw near and relieve their suffering. And within our community, we pray for Peter, for Carol, for Caroline, Francine, Juliet and her family, Adrian, Jennifer and their family, Melvin, John, Patrick, Martin and Sam, Jonathan and his family, and all those whom God has placed in our hearts. light, hope, and restoration. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father, at this time of remembrance, we bless your holy name for all who in life and death have glorified you and those whom we love but see no longer. And today we especially pray for the souls of Jean and Peter, that you will receive them with mercy, and that they may know the full brightness of your presence. We pray for John Seagram and all his family who mourn for Jean, and for Alice Martin, their family, and all who mourn for Peter. Give us grace that, rejoicing in their fellowship, we may follow their good example, and with them, St. Stephen, Mary, the Mother of God, we may share your heavenly kingdom. Grant these prayers, O merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, our Mediator and Redeemer. Amen. The service continues on page 8 of the booklet. Ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbours, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this holy sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them that with hearty repentance and true faith turn unto him, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ saith unto all that truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under thy table. But thou art the same Lord, whose property is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto our Lord God. It is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, Everlasting God. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee
and singing. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of thy tender mercy didst give thine only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death upon the cross for our redemption, who made thereby his one oblation of himself once offered a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and did institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, O merciful Father, we most humbly beseech thee, and grant that we, receiving these thy creatures of bread and wine, according to thy Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. In the same night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Wherefore, O Lord and Heavenly Father, we thy humble servants entirely desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and lively sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of this holy communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction. And although we be unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offences, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honour and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. Now, as our Saviour hath commanded and taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we most heartily thank thee for that thou dost vouchsafe to feed us who duly receive these holy mysteries with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of thy Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, and dost assure us thereby of thy favour and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporate in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of the most precious death and passion of thy dear Son. And we most humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue in that holy fellowship and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honour and glory, world without end. Amen. Well, many thanks indeed to all of you for celebrating with us at St. Stephen Walbrook. Particular thanks to Olivia, the choir, and to Stephen on the organ. As you know, we are blessed with wonderful organists here, and we have Michael Nicholas, who for many years was organist and choir master at Norwich Cathedral, performing tomorrow at 12:30, and then a week tomorrow at 12 noon. Sir Andrew Palmley, formerly Lord Mayor of the city, is performing what he says will be his last public recital. So it'd be wonderful to have your support for that. And next week we're celebrating the Feast of Christ the King. The choral scholars will sing choral classics on Wednesday at 12:30, and Choral Eucharist at the same time next Thursday, 12:45, when they'll sing Mozart's fabulous coronation mass. Do join us for that. And then we start to look towards Christmas, our first carol service for the Samaritans is a mere 2 weeks away. Then our parish carol service, as indicated on the leaflet, is on Wednesday the 14th of December at 6 p.m. And it'll be a special carol service this year, in that that'll be 3 days before the 350th anniversary of the founding of this building. We'll be celebrating that and Wren's 300th anniversary at a special service in February. Do have a wonderful week, and God bless you all. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be with you and all whom you love, today and always. Amen.